whose I am. I'll never understand why he saw a piece of clay and said, I want it, I'll use it. The greatest mystery is somehow, in spite of me, he said, I'm gonna love you. He took me in his arms, said, this child belongs to me. He placed me in his kingdom, now I live like royalty. It's not because of what I am, it's not because of what I've done, but because of whose I am. My Father is Lord of everything from here beyond forever. He's given me his name, said if I'd ask anything, he'd gladly give it.
He'd give it to me, even to me.
He put a robe upon my back. He put a ring upon my hand,
said the riches of heaven were all mine.
It's not because of what I am, it's not because of what I've done, but because he first loved me. His grace has set me free. His blood is flowing through my veins. I'm adopted by the King.
Just because of whose
I am. He put a robe upon my back. He put a ring upon my hand. Said the riches of heaven
were all mine.
Dedicate that to the devil tonight. Want him to know about that. Praise the Lord. That's good. I'm glad you're here tonight. What a crowd tonight. That just proves that you feed a bunch of Baptists and they'll show up. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, I'm glad you're here. I know some of you have been exhausted. One deacon came up to me and said, it's my first night. I've been sick. And God raised him up to get him here during the revival. And I praise the Lord for that. And I'll have to catch up on all the things I've said about deacons and lay it all on him tonight. But if I did that, it'd take too long, so we'll just get right on with what we're doing. Will you put those Bibles down? You bunch of fanatics. Weirdos. Strange people around this church. You know, you folks are hard to preach to. Let me tell you why. Now, you probably think that's an insult, but it's a compliment. Let me tell you why. I'm going to tell you why you're hard to preach to, and then I'm going to tell you something maybe you hadn't thought about. You're hard to preach to because you've heard some of the best preaching in the world just on Sundays and Wednesdays with your pastor. Well, go ahead and clap if you want to, because I know it's true. He don't leave much to say. So what you have to rely on is the different style to at least make it sound different. Because I know you've been told just about everything there is. Now here's the other part. It's the good news, bad news kind of thing. That was the good news. Here's the bad news.
Jesus said, to whom much is given, much is required. This church is obligated to walk a tighter line and a thinner line than most churches in the state of California or in the Southern Baptist Convention. Because, folks, he wasn't just talking about material possessions. He wasn't talking about money. He wasn't talking about position. He was talking about anything. Those things included. But he was talking about knowledge as well. To whom much is given, much is required. And you are obligated to walk in the light that God gives you to walk in. And the more light you receive, the more obligation and responsibility you have to walk in that light. So if you decide to disobey God, you would have been better off if you had been in a church that did not preach like this church preached. Because God holds you more accountable because of the light you've been given. Now, I don't want that to confuse anybody theologically, but I want to assure you it's correct. And you don't need to sit there and say, well, now, what about that church down the street? That's not who we're talking about tonight. We're talking about you. So forget about everything else and all those questions Satan can put in your mind from that, and just say to yourself, hey, I'm under this ministry in this church, and God's feeding me more abundantly than most people are getting in the state of California now. What am I going to do with it? Now, friend, I want you to know God's putting a lot of responsibility on your shoulders. And I praise God for the amount of people you're reaching. And I praise God for the way this church is growing. But I want you to know that you have not done what God wants you to do yet. And I want you to know also, friends, that you are not living up. Listen, anybody play golf in here? Let me see the golfers. Would you raise your hand? Okay, I didn't say good. I just said you play golf, all right? Play. I said that for Ed's benefit because I saw him raise his hand. You either play it or play at it. All right. Now, by the way, Brother Richard, I said that about your joke a while ago, but I want people to know I love you. And I want folks to know that I wouldn't kid you if I didn't love you. Okay, I just want you. I'm glad to know I fit in. All right? I play golf, but I haven't played since I've been in the state of California. For several reasons, which are not important to what I'm about to say. But back when I pastored back in South Carolina, I played every Monday. I picked Monday for two reasons. One, I needed to unwind from Sunday. And two, the golf course let preachers play free on Monday. The best time I know to go, brother. So we all went. All of us preachers went there. We'd have a little coffee or something before, and we'd go on up to the golf course, and we'd play golf. And I had a golfing buddy named Carlos Peterson. Maybe you remember Carlos Peterson. Carlos was pastor of the Fuss Baptist Church down the street from us. Carlos did not fit at the Fuss Baptist Church. Because Carlos just preached the Word of God like it was. And they didn't like that. So Carlos was having problems. He only lasted about 6 months after I left. He pulled on out. He couldn't take it anymore. They just gave him a rough time for it. But he really needed that session of fellowship on Monday. So I made sure he was my golfing buddy. There was one other reason I made sure he was my golfing buddy. He's the worst golfer I've ever seen in all my life. And I loved to go play against Carlos Peterson. He was so much fun. I'd have to wait on Carlos. I'd be sitting on the green. Waiting. My ball would be sitting there waiting to be put it in. And I'd hear Carlos somewhere down the fairway saying, 4, 5, 6. Finally, he'd get there. And I'd say, oh, it's good to have you here, Carlos. And we'd put on out. And Carlos would say, every Monday, he'd say, Barry, let's don't keep score today. Let's just play for the fun of it. I'd say, no, I'm keeping score. And I'd write that score down. It's funny. We played a little game. We'd name our golf balls after deacons. I'd get some of the longest drives that way. Especially when I name one the chairman of deacons. I mean, I could just hit that thing a mile. It always sliced or hooked. I don't know why that particular ball. I didn't usually have a hook or a slice, but every time I'd name it a chairman of deacons, it'd do one of those. He never could do anything straight anyway, and it always worked that way. Now, where's that new deacon that hadn't been here this week? Raise your hand. What, you done got ashamed of it already? Where are you? Oh, there he is. So I'm just catching up, brother, all right? I thought I'd throw in a few deacon remarks, okay? You just keep smiling, all right? I like the way you part your hair in a semicircle. I like that. That's good. That's great. And Carlos and I had a lot of fun. We had a good time. I can see right now this man loves the Lord because he's taking that. You got to love the Lord to take some of the things I say and kidding. So I just praise the Lord for that. But Carlos and I would play golf every Monday, and I just beat him to death on the golf course. Ed, you like to play folks like that every once in a while, don't you? You played Brother Jim before. Okay, that makes sense. All right. Now, against Carlos Peterson, I felt like Jack Nicklaus. I was ready for the Palm Springs Desert Classic. I was ready for Pebble Beach when I compared my game against Carlos Peterson. Man, I was ready for anybody. And I'd come back to the office every Monday afternoon just as bright and cheery-eyed as I could get because I had torn Carlos Peterson up. I'd come back and all the staff say, "How'd you do today?" I'd say, "Man, I won. I did great. I tore Carlos out." One day one of them got smart aleck and said, "How'd you do against par?" Anybody know about golf? Par is that score that the golf course says you ought to be able to do it in if you're any good. Against Carlos Peterson, I was Jack Nicklaus, ready to play Pebble Beach. Against par, I was ready to throw my clubs into Pebble Beach. I was terrible. Our churches go to these conventions and go to these associational meetings, and we say, "Boy, we done good. We're fifth in the state. We're seventh in the state." Which one of y'all? Fifth, seventh? What is it? Yes, I named two of them. What do you mean, yes? What are you, Richard? Fifth or seventh? Third and seventh. You can explain that later, all right? We're third and seventh in the state. Does that make you 37th? What? Boy, we're doing good. Just think, all them other churches under us. We're third in one area and seventh in another area in the state. Just think about that. Boy, we look good. Rob Zinn came up here a year ago. Their church number one in the state in baptisms. Oh, we're doing great. How you doing against par? If I was you, I'd get tired of playing the Carlos Petersons in this world. And I'd start trying to measure up to par. And against the Carlos Petersons in this state, y'all are third and seventh. Against par. Where are you? You playing par golf yet? No. The Bible says the Lord added to the church daily. That means at least 365 and a fourth ought to get saved every year. Baptized. And then the Bible says they quit adding and started multiplying. And you know the simple multiplication plan, don't you? The pyramid plan. If one of you said tonight, "I'm going to win one person a month to Jesus and teach that person how to win somebody." You know that's a great commission, don't you? The great commission is not to win folks. The great commission is to win them, baptize them, and teach them to win others. That's the great commission. And you know if you said, "I'm going to win one a month and teach that person how to win one a month, and next month we're both going to win one a month," do you know how many you'd win in a year? Want to run through it with me right quick? Every time I give you a phrase, every time I give you a number, you name out the month it is, okay? Like the first month, you have two. Well, you don't have to do January. You just say one, okay? Just say one. That's one month. Let's try it again. Boy, these folks are intelligent.
Everywhere else I go, they have a hard time figuring out what number to say. These folks say, January. Huh? I know. They all said the same month. I can't figure that out. And here it is, February. All right. Just name the number, okay? One. That's how many months. We're counting months, okay? All right. The first month, you got two. That's good. That's great. The next month, you have four. Then you have eight. Then 16. Then 32. Then 64. Then 128. Then 256. Then 512. Then 1,024. Then 2,048. Then 4,096. 4,096 people in 1 year because one person said, I'll win one a month and teach them how to win one a month. 4,096. And you got maybe 100 soul winners in this church. And out of 100 dedicated soul winners, do you realize how many people that would be? 500,000 people. Brother Barry, everybody won't keep up their end of the bargain. That's why it's important for you to win 5 or 6 a month to make up for the slack. But Brother Barry, what if that's good on the drawing board, but what if it's not a reality? Okay, what if you fail and only win 2,000? Wouldn't that be terrible? Or what if you really are a bum at this thing and only win 500? Wouldn't that be terrible? Or what if you're just a miserable, low-down, rotten failure and only win 100? Wouldn't that be terrible? And 100 of you, just miserable, rotten, low-down failures, and only win 100 each, that's 10,000 people that you won to Jesus in a year by being a low-down, rotten, miserable failure. That's par. That's getting near par. Now, you tired of playing the Carlos Petersons? Then let's get to measuring up to what par says. We can give the invitation to go home right now. But I'm not going to, all right? Okay, turn to Romans. And this ain't no joke, all right? Chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, and you're saying to yourself, now we know all there is to know about Romans chapter 4. The Lord told me to preach Romans chapter 4, and I said, time out. This pastor has dissected Romans chapter 4. He has gone over it with a fine-tooth comb. He has looked at it with a magnifying glass. Don't worry, I'll have you wave them in a minute, all right? He's looked at it with a magnifying glass. Lord, why would you have me preach Romans chapter 4? And God said there's something He wants to show you in it. That either He didn't show you, or if He showed you, you didn't retain it all because you only retain 20% of what you hear. That's why it takes Him so long to preach through Romans. Because He wants to make sure you get it. I admire preachers can do that. I can't do that. I admire preachers can preach like that, and I want some tapes. I want to hear how he does it. All right? Okay, now, everybody's got a Bible, get it up. Put your finger in Romans chapter 4 and shake it at the devil. All right? Okay, good. Begin reading with verse 16. The Lord also said that this pastor doesn't have the same experiences that I do and the same illustrations that I do. And the illustrations will benefit you in understanding Romans chapter 4 a little bit better. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed. Not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. Who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, He considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. I want to stop there. Read the last verse again. And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Father, in Jesus' name, minister life to us tonight. I praise you, Lord, for the rest and the revival of body and strength that you've given these people. For I sense tonight a complete difference than last night, and I realize last night was exhaustion on the part of many people. But Lord, you worked last night and people were saved and lives were rededicated and revival fires were stirred up and people's lives were changed, and we praise you for that. But that was last night. Now we're here tonight for you to do whatever you want to do in our lives. We lay ourselves before you and say, God, whatever it takes, do it to bring honor and glory to Jesus. And we'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Faith. Isn't that an amazing thing? I love that idea of faith and how to make it work. Faith is the hardest thing that man can do, because man operates in the sense world. What he can taste, touch, smell, see, and hear. And that's the way the secular world operates. And sadly, that is the way most churches operate. What they can taste, touch, smell, see, and hear. And if it doesn't make sense, if it doesn't slide rule, if it doesn't calculate, if it doesn't compute, we don't do it. But faith takes us, as Bill Stafford says, out of the sense world and elevates us to another world called the faith world. And that world must be the world that we operate in so we can get into this world and bring about miracles in our lives. But you cannot walk in the sense world where you have to examine something before you'll trust God for it. You must operate in that extra sixth sense that God gives us called faith. Reminds me so much of, Baptists remind me so much of back home. I don't know about out here, but back home we got power lines all over the place, and doves sit on power lines. Or any kind of bird sit on power lines. And I drove by one day and looked up, and there must have been 500 birds down the power line just sitting there. And birds back home are crazy. If you were to walk up and shoot one of them, all the rest of them around them would go. And just sit there. And I got to look at those birds and I said, you know, that's just like most Baptists. Those birds don't realize what they're sitting on, because they're insulated from the power. If they ever found a crack in that insulation and got a claw down in it, they'd know what they were sitting on. You wouldn't have to explain it to them. It'd be obvious what they were sitting on. And most Baptists have allowed the world, they've allowed unbelief, they've allowed a lack of faith, they've allowed love of the world, they've allowed sin in their lives to insulate them from the power of God, and Baptists don't realize what they're sitting on. But we're sitting on more power than the world has ever thought possible. And that power is ours if we'll quit being insulated from it and learn how to release it in our lives. And Abraham's our best example of how to release that power in our lives. First of all, we see a description or definition of what faith is. 17th verse, calling those things which be not as though they were. Bill Stafford, you ever going to have Bill Stafford up here? I hope you are. I really do. I want these people to hear Brother Bill Stafford and let him minister to these folks. They'll never be the same. Never. Brother Bill Stafford taught me more about faith. Everything I know about faith I learned from Bill Stafford and Manly Beasley. And about everything Manly knows, he learned from Bill, I think. I don't know how that works. But Brother Bill Stafford just taught me so much about faith. And he calls faith this: believing it ain't when it is so it can be. I mean, believing it is when it ain't, so it can be. Now, I threw you off with those ain'ts, and you didn't even know if I said it right to start with. Try it again. Believing it is when it ain't, so it can be. Want me to try it again? Believing something is, even though it's not. I'll put it in English so they can understand it. Believing something is, even though it's not,
so it can be. Because God waits until He sees you acting like it is and believing it is before He ever brings it about. The world has taught you seeing is believing. That's a lie. Thomas thought that. Seeing is believing. When I put my finger in the nail print and put my hand in his side, I'll believe. Jesus turned to him and said, Thomas, you believe because you've seen. But blessed, happy, and contented are those that believe and have not seen. Now, I got to admire Thomas in one respect. He was at least honest about his unbelief. He didn't go around saying, well, if these other guys believe it, I better believe it too and just not let them think I'm stupid. He at least was honest about it. And I can handle somebody like that. I'd a lot rather you come to me and say, hey, I don't see it. I don't understand it, than to pretend and go along with the crowd, because that'll never get you anything. But Thomas found out from Jesus firsthand what he was talking about, and Thomas believed from then on. I don't believe you could tell Thomas anything after that and he wouldn't believe it. I believe he'd believe everything from then on. Blessed, happy, contented are those that believe and have not seen. God's waiting on you to act like it is. Instead of saying seeing is believing, is go ahead, believing is seeing. Because believing will bring it about so you can see it happen. Baptists want to shout after God does something. The shouting comes before God does it. That's your shout of faith. That's your shout of victory in advance. That's why you walking around so miserable. I'm just waiting for God to do something in my life. I see all these folks getting miracles, and I see these folks getting saved. Their friends are getting saved. And God never does nothing in my life, and I wish He would, because I got a shout just waiting in here to get out. I practiced. I'm primed and ready. Why don't you just stand on a promise of God, go to shouting about it, and watch God bring it about in your life. That's the way faith works. That's what He's been teaching you about faith? All right, then we can go on from here with it. That is faith. Acting like those things that are not really are, so they can be. And that's what He said here. Calling those things which be not as though they were. Now, you keep that in mind, and I'm going to show you about it as we go along. That's the definition of faith. How did it work for Abraham? Verse 18 said, first of all, he got a word from God. You look at it. According to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. I want you to know that faith starts with a word from God. There'll be some people on TV or radio or other folks that might send out mail outs or something that will try to teach you that you can just believe God for anything, doesn't matter. And you can get it if you've got enough faith. You can believe God for 14 Cadillacs. You can believe God for 5 mansions and a cabin up in Tahoe. You can believe God for all kinds of things. But I want you to know faith starts with a word from God. But Barry, the Bible says He'll give me the desires of my heart. You read that passage in Psalms and you'll find out that if you have all these things in line, your desires will be His desires. And you will only want what He wants in your life. Trust in the Lord and commit your ways unto Him, the Bible said. And then those desires come about. Why? Because my desires have changed from various fleshly desires to what God wants in my life. You see the key there? It's got to be what God wants. I had a fellow tell me one time, now that I'm saved, I can do anything I want to and it's all right with God. I said, time out. You can't do that. He said, yes, I can. I said, you crazy. You can't do anything you want to, man. You think salvation's covered you and given you a license to sin? He said, I didn't say that. He said, but when I got saved, I realized He was Lord of my life. And I decided right then it didn't matter what I wanted anymore. It just mattered what He wanted. And now all I want to do is what pleases Him. So I can do anything I want to and it's all right with God. Because all I want is to please Him, right? Okay. So you got to make sure your desires are in line with His. And His desires are what is best for you. Okay, so I desire to please Him. I desire His will in my life. So you got to get a word from God, a promise from God. You say, Brother Barry, how do I know there's a promise for me? There was a special one for Abraham, but how do I know there's one for me? There's not one for you. There are thousands for you in this word.
Not just 1,000. You need to dig into them and find out what they are. But they're there, and you can stand on them and claim them, and God will bring them to pass. You say, you don't put God on the spot like that. I don't have to put God on the spot. He's wanting me to find those promises. He's wanting me to stand on them. He's wanting to bless me. He's wanting to pour out things in my life that are His will in my life. But He's waiting for me to find out what they are. The Bible says that the promises of God are find their yea in Jesus. That means their yes in Him. They were made possible by Calvary, by the death and resurrection of Jesus. But they get our amen from us, which means God has already made those promises available. He's simply waiting on our agreement with Him to bring them about. Okay? Now, first of all, he got a word from God. Then he had to deny the sense world. Look at the 19th verse. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. You know me and that imagination I have. Can you picture that? He's 99 years old and Sarah's 90. And God says, you're going to have a son. 99 and 90, and you're going to have a son. And the Bible says he did not consider his own deadness. Now, does that mean the man was dead? No. That means, though, physically, he was not capable of producing a child. Okay? Simply means that. He's not capable of producing a child. Deadness of himself, nor the deadness of Sarah's womb, and not just because of her age, but she's been able to conceive the whole time. And he denied that. Can't you see it now? He goes home and tells Sarah, we're going to have a child. Well, actually, Sarah heard it. We're going to have a child. She laughed. Wouldn't you? Don't get nervous, folks. I'm not going to... This ain't no nightclub act or nothing. This is the Word of God, all right? Don't get nervous on me. We're talking intelligent things here. I'll be delicate enough for little ears. Don't worry about that. But I'm trying to let you know, I'm trying to help you see the Word of God and what it says. Bill Stafford says, Sarah had any sense, she wouldn't have laughed, she'd have cried, because what 90-year-old woman wants to have a baby? But now here comes the faith. Sarah could have said, Abe, you're 99, son. There ain't no sense in it. He could have said, Sarah, you ain't no spring chicken yourself. You're 90 years old, babe. There ain't no hope. Let me tell you where the faith came in. The faith was just not believing God could do that. The faith wasn't even in just denying the fact that it could happen. Let me tell you, and I told you I'd be delicate here for little ears. And teenagers, I'm not saying anything to be funny, so don't you laugh at it. You just think about it a minute. The faith was in them even trying. There was the faith. There was the act of faith. So you can sit down all day long and believe God can do something. Yeah, I believe God can do that. I believe it'll happen. But it won't happen until you act on it. And the only one that I know of in the Word of God that ever had a baby without that act is Mary. Sarah was not going to be the exception. They had to have the act in order to bring about the miracle. And there's where he denied it. That doesn't mean when it says it denied, he denied his own deadness, that doesn't mean he just looked at himself and said, oh well, I'm still able. That means they even attempted. They even bothered to come together and try. There was the act of faith. And God honored it. What good would it have done them to sit around and say, yeah, Sarah, I believe you can have a baby. Sarah said, yeah, Abraham, I believe that could work. No good at all. until you act on that faith. And then he went around telling everybody, Sarah's going to have a baby. I just see him now. Meets the First Baptist pastor. Preacher, better get a new crib in the nursery. Well, what's the matter? You got a friend that's going to, you inviting to church that's got a baby? Oh, no. I know somebody's going to have a baby. Oh, yeah, neighbor of yours? No, Sarah. Now, Abraham, that's not baptistic. That's not the way it's done. You know good and well you're going to make a fool out of us if you go around here telling everybody your wife's going to have a baby, because you know that ain't possible. So don't go around telling folks about it. Now, if it happens, okay. Then you can tell folks. But don't tell anybody now, because chances are it won't happen. See, that's the way the world tells you to do. And that's what you tell you to do. Let's wait till we see it. Then we'll tell everybody about it. But that's not faith. Faith was Abraham telling folks about it, so then it can happen. So when you pray about something and you know it's God's will and you've committed it to God, go ahead and tell folks. Act on it in faith. But they'll think I'm crazy. It's all right. Just go right ahead. Because God will honor it by bringing it about. But he had to deny that sense world, didn't he? And you look around you and you're going to pray and commit something to God and trust Him for a miracle, but the sense world says that ain't going to happen. You've got to deny it and say, I don't care if it looks like it can't happen. I don't care if it looks totally impossible. God is doing it right now. It is done. Manly Beasley says, faith's a three-legged stool, like a three-legged milking stool. You ever milked a cow? Yeah. Three-legged milking stool. Without one of those legs, you'll fall flat on your face. I preached this at Emmanuel Baptist Church, Rob Zinn's church, and afterwards a man came up to me from back in Kentucky. He said, Preacher, I don't know how you milk cows where you come from in Georgia, but if I was on a three-legged milking stool in Kentucky one cold morning and one of those legs broke, it was not my face I fell on. So I said, well, if it's all the same to you, I'd rather keep that phrase in my sermon, because it's more delicate to say it that way. Faith is believing God can do it. Faith is believing God will do it. But faith is not complete until you believe God has done it before you see the answer. It's already on the way. You don't know when it's coming. You just know it's there. And you don't talk in terms of, I hope it's going to happen, or I think it's going to happen, or you just wait till it happens. You talk in terms of, it has already happened. That's hard for some of you to grasp. Some of y'all going to go away from me tonight saying, I don't believe any of that stuff. When preachers get off on that tangent, I just close my ears and shut them out. Well, you go right ahead, because it ain't for you probably. It's only for those that will believe. And those that will exercise it by faith. But those that do, it works. So don't tell them that it don't work. All right? Don't spoil the fun for them. You go ahead and be intelligent if you want to. Let them stupid folks get their prayers answered. And let them stupid folks get miracles from God. You just go ahead and be smart, though. That's all right. You let us ignorant folks live right on like we're living. Now, Abraham had a third thing happen to him. He had strength enough, and got his strength through praising God. Look at this in the 20th verse. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. I got ahead of myself a while ago. That's the point where he went around telling folks. Giving glory to God. Praising Him for what He's already done in your life. Giving glory to God for it. And there's where we get our strength. The more you praise God about it, the more confidence you get up in your ability to praise Him even more about it. So just keep praising God for what He's already done. Now, I'm running through these points because I've got a few illustrations to show you tonight to give you practical application of how this works. And then the last point, his confidence. And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform it. Did you know that if God promised something, he can pull it off? Do you know that? If God promised you anything and couldn't do it, He's a liar. And if He's a liar, I'm wasting my time and yours tonight. If He's a liar, I've hinged my life and my family's life on the wrong thing. But God's not a liar. So whatever He promised, I am fully persuaded. Not almost persuaded, not 99% sure. I am fully 100% sure that He is able to perform whatever He promised He'd do. All right? Whatever. 100%. Okay. I was in a little church, a little area in South Georgia. Started a church from scratch. I love to do that. It's an exciting thing. Had 5 members in that church that we started. Now, they were not a church. We got there, we met, we decided to form a church. I was in evangelism, and I'd been in that area, and I'd researched that area, and I'd get letters from folks saying, "Brother Barry, since we got saved, there's just nowhere to go. There's no place that's feeding us. There's no place that's teaching about Jesus." And I couldn't believe that. So I did a little research, brother. And you know we Baptists put out an associational book every year, Book of Reports. So I got the Book of Reports from that association. And in that little area, that little association, there were 3 main towns. And in each of those 3 main towns, there was a Fuss Baptist church in each one. Now, back home, Fuss Baptist means something. Out here, don't mean a whole lot, except in Modesto. I think that's the largest church around here. But down in Southern California, you're the First Baptist church, you could have 10 members. It's just not that much out here. But back home, Fuss Baptist is the country club set. Everybody belongs to the Fuss Baptist. Everybody does. That's the elite. Man, when you move to town and start a business, you join the First Baptist Church to improve your business. That's the way it works. So I looked up all those First Baptist churches, and you know what? The 3 main First Baptist churches that whole year that associational report covered baptized a total of 2 people. A total of 2 people. I checked on that by calling some folks and found out those 2 were junior boys in Bible school that got baptized on the last day of Bible school. That's it. No adults won to Christ. No teenagers won to Christ. Just 2 junior boys. Junior boys ain't nothing against you, okay? But I'm just pointing out that more people than that have got to get saved in order for a church to be in God's will. So I said, man, I looked at all of it, and the whole association baptized a total of 40 people that year, and there were 62 churches in the association. And God said, go and start a church. So went up there, we started a church, Gospel Baptist Temple. We started a church. 5 people. Met in an American Legion building. Now, I tell you this only to give honor and glory to the Lord Jesus. If anybody thinks I'm telling it for any other reason, you're wrong. Because it's like Moses. I had the tail end of this thing just watching God work. Because I didn't know what was going on. The first year, we baptized 285 people. It was easy. Nobody heard the gospel around there. Nobody was preaching. Brother, I preached a series on Wednesday night going through the book of Revelation. And for that time of going through the book of Revelation, took us 30 weeks, I think it was. It'd take you 30 years, but it took us 30 weeks. It wouldn't do any good for him to do a study of Revelation and raptured come before he ever got through it. But I did a study on Revelation. It took us 30 weeks. And during that 30-week period, we averaged 500 on Sunday morning, 500 on Sunday night. And I didn't even preach it on Sundays. That was on Wednesdays I did Revelation. 500 on Sunday morning, 500 on Sunday night, and 500 on Wednesday night. You say, Brother Barry, what size town was that? The town had a population of 3,000. That's it. Not 300,000, not 30,000, 3,000 people. After 2 years, we had 575 members. 225 of them were teenagers. 225. Youth weekends were unbelievable. Saturday nights, youth get-togethers. And all the young people sat down front. Man, you had to come early to get a front row seat at our church. Young people sitting down there with pads and pencils ready to go, taking notes. They'd take a note on everything you said. They took notes on announcements. They'd take notes on everything. One day, a young lady came to our church from the high school there named Lynn Sands. She was Miss Everything. She's a beautiful young girl. She was Miss County, Miss City, Miss every kind of contest they had, she won it. She was Miss all of it, homecoming queen, everything else. She came and got saved. And her parents were big wheels in the First Methodist Church. That's everybody that didn't go to the Baptist church went to that church. And she went home and told her mama about it, Ann Sands. Told her mama. Said, Mama, I got saved. She said, huh? She said, I got saved. Ann said, what does that mean? She said, well, I met Jesus. She said, you've always known Jesus. She said, not like this, I ain't. She said, well, tell me about it. And she told her about it. And she said, Lynn, I don't understand it. And Lynn said, I don't either, Mama, but I know I got it. And a week later, Ann went to her and said, Lynn, I'm convinced you got it too, because I see a difference in you all this week than I've ever seen before in your whole 18 years. She said, you reckon I could go to that church and find out what's going on? She said, come on, Mama. Ann came that Sunday night. Had a fur coat on, glasses with a necklace around, you know, and all that. Just gray-headed lady, pretty lady, dignified. Man, she looked extinguished. She really... So she said, I got saved right then. She told me later, she said, I found out what to call it now. I got saved. So Ann started coming with Lynn. And they couldn't get Carson to come. Carson go on Sunday mornings to the First Methodist Church to make his appearance. But other than that, he wouldn't go. Carson Sam was the wickedest man in all of Evans County. He was drunk every weekend. He run around with every woman that would run and tried to run with them that wouldn't. He'd just soon shoot you as to look at you. And he was the richest farmer in the area. I saw his financial statement later. $4 million the man was worth. Out here in California, that's a drop in the bucket for some folks. But back in the East, when you got $4 million, it's like J. Paul Getty, friend. You're rich if you're worth $4 million. And he was the richest farmer in the area. Thousands of acres of land, thousands of acres just to hunt on. Had all kinds of stuff set up. And Carson wouldn't come to church. He sure wouldn't come to Gospel Baptist Temple. That was a circus down there. Why, people come just to check us out because they'd heard what a weird bunch we were. We clapped our hands. We raised our hands. We hugged each other. We clapped. We laughed. We had a good time. Music was great. We had choir singing. We just had glorious times. Fun. Yeah. Christians can have fun. I was on the radio every day at 12:30. If you're on the radio at 12:30 in a little southern town, you got the audience. They don't watch TV. They listen to the gossip news. And I had the audience. And boy, I'd tell them about Jesus and preach and just get people stirred up and get them all riled up. And there was a Church of Christ preacher on every morning at 7 o'clock. And he'd spend the morning time, 15 minutes, telling all that I said wrong the day before. And he just tear me apart every time. And I said one time, we had fun. We enjoyed Jesus. And he got on there the next day and said, you don't enjoy Jesus. You enjoy cake and ice cream, but you don't enjoy Jesus. So I got on there and I said, come on down. We won't give you no cake and ice cream, but we'll make you feel like you had some because we're going to enjoy Jesus. One day I looked out over that crowd and that auditorium we were meeting in hold 500 people. And we were having 500 every service. And then we got to where we was having to sit people in the floor, sit folks up on the platform. And I went to God and I said, God, we got to have a place of our own. And God said, I know. And God gave me a promise. Wherever two or if two agree as touching anything, it shall be given.
Now, I knew it was God's will for us to have a place to meet. He didn't want us meeting in American Legion building all the time. Especially when they'd have a dance on Saturday night, we'd have to come in and clean the beer cans out on Sunday morning before we could have church. I said, I ain't putting up with much of that anymore. I want our own place. So I knew that was God's will. So I said, one Sunday night, I said, folks, we're going to fast. They thought I said feast, we're going to have a potluck dinner or something, but it's fast. See, Baptists don't think about that very often, but Jesus said these things come by prayer and fasting. And Jesus did not say, I hope y'all will fast every once in a while. You study fasting, you'll find out that every verse of Scripture, he had anything to say about fasting, this is what he said. When you fast, do this, 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 and this. He didn't say, if you do. He didn't say, I hope you do. He didn't say, once a year do. He said, when you do. Jesus assumed that you would fast. Because you need that to bring that power into your life. So I called a fast. The pastor has the right to do that. So I said, all those who will join in with me, we're going to fast. And I know you folks can't take a real big fast to start with because you've never done it in your life. So we'll fast one meal a day, Monday and Tuesday. And then Wednesday, we'll not eat anything all day long. And we're going to pray three times a day for the Lord to answer our prayer. And we're going to agree that God's going to provide the place for us to meet. Now, I prayed about it, and here's what I feel like we ought to do. I said, I feel like you ought to put a church in the place where folks are going to see it most. You don't stick a church off in the back alley somewhere. You put it where folks are going to see it. Now, there's one highway running through that town. That's it. The rest of them are just streets. One highway, Highway 301, runs from Miami to New York. Some of you may know about it. But that booger run right through that city we were in, that town that we were in. And I said, folks, I've examined it. Town ain't going north. Nothing but junkyards there. Town's moving south. So I want us to pray that God will give us some property south of town. Not too far south, but south of town. On Highway 301, on a hill where folks can see it. But I don't want a half acre to stick a building on. I want enough land for us to grow and for us to provide the things necessary to minister to people's lives, even a school and a college if necessary. So we need at least 10 acres. And they're all going. What's our preacher been eating? And then I said, oh, by the way, pray that it's free. I don't want to have to pay for it. They knew I'd flip then. Ann sitting there listening to it, she's going, everybody, just bug-eyed. I said, oh, one other thing. Wednesday night, be sure and be here. I'm going to announce where our property is. Because God's going to give it to us by Wednesday night. Now, I got that word from the Lord. I just got an assurance in my heart that if we'd fast those days and then on Wednesday all day, just fast, nothing eating, that God would provide it if we'd pray and believe it. I said, now, if you don't believe this, don't you open your mouth and pray it. Because I don't want you canceling out what we're doing. But only those that believe it, you pray with me. And some believed it, and they prayed with me. I got on the radio the next day and told the whole town that Wednesday night I was going to announce where our new property was. I got a call from one of my men and said, preacher, do you think that was wise? He said, why not wait till Thursday and announce what you announced Wednesday night? I said, because that ain't what the Word of God says. I said, I'm going to praise God in advance for what He's done. That's what Abraham did. That's what I'm going to do. So every day I was announcing that. Man, people listen. They go all over streets talking. You can hear it. You can hear it. My member said, everywhere you went, you go in a store, a lady be buying hose. She'd be saying to the clerk, you heard what that weirdo said on the radio? Wednesday night, we had a crowd there. But let me tell you what happened in the meantime. Oh, I got to back up a minute. I preached a sermon on faith about claiming God's promises. And Ann Sands found a promise in studying God's Word. She found 1 Peter 3. 1 Peter 3 says, if any of you wives have a husband who's not saved, if you will submit yourselves to him, and in true submission as Sarah did, if you will honor that man and keep your mouth shut, God will work on his heart and he'll get saved. That's what the Word of God said. She came to me one night and said, "Preacher, is that a promise?" I said, "That's a promise." She says, "Does that mean if I do that, Carson will get saved?" I said, "That's right. That's what it means." She said, "Can you guarantee me that?" I said, "No, but God can because He said it." She said, "You mean I can stand on that?" I said, "You can stand on it." She said, "Would you pray with me?" I said, "Yeah." We got down there in the altar boy and we prayed after the service. We prayed. I put up a good one. I prayed and prayed and prayed and claimed that thing and we agreed together. And I got through praying. I was hoarse. I'd prayed so hard. I looked at her and I said, "Now, Ann, do you believe Carson's going to get saved?" She said, "Nope." I said, "My goodness. Woman, what's wrong with you?" I said, "Why don't you believe he's going to get saved?" She said, "Because he already is. He just don't know it yet." Huh? That's faith. Treating those things that are not as though they were. She said, "I'm not going to believe he's going to get saved. I believe God saved him right then. He's just going to find out about it later on." She went home, boy. She treated him like he was the king of the world. He couldn't understand what was going on. But he'd heard about that radio broadcast too, and he thought his wife was going to a church where the preacher was going to make a fool out of her and everybody else. I got a call from Ann Wednesday morning. Now, God hadn't showed us a thing about property. People saying, "Where's your property?" I said, "I don't know where it is. God's already got it picked out. He just hadn't told me where it is yet." Got a call from Ann. She said, "Preacher, my husband wants to talk to you." I said, "Oh, Lord. I told you he's the meanest man in the county." She said, "By the way, preacher, I want to tell you about a miracle last night." I said, "Tell me about it." She said, "My husband got mad at a man who was coming over to see him. And my husband laid out under his car with a shotgun and was going to blow that man's head off. My husband was so drunk. And she said he was going to blow his head off with a shotgun if he had come." And she said, "I went back and got in the bedroom and got on my knees and prayed God keep that man away, and he never showed up." I said, "Ann, I praise God for the miracle, but I want to tell you your timing is rotten in telling me about it." "Because I'm about to go over and see that man." "So what time does he want me?" She said, 2:00. I said, "All right, I'll be there." I pulled up in the yard at 2:00. I opened my door and I looked under his car. He wasn't there, so I got out and knocked on the door. He come to the door and opened it up. First time I'd seen him. The Lord said, "Don't go visit him or anything. Let Ann do 1 Peter 3. Leave him alone. Because it says he may be won without the word, without anybody nagging him about the word. He'll be won by her pure behavior." So I stayed away from him. First time I'd ever seen him, he opened the door. They ain't nobody looked more like Ben Cartwright than Ben Cartwright except him. He looked just like him. He was a stout man, had gray hair, sideburns down to here, solid white hair. And he was about this tall, and he weighed about 230 pounds, and there wasn't an ounce of fat on him. Built like a fire hydrant, just stood there. Said, "Come on in, preacher." I said, "All right." And I eased in, and I noticed over on the table, just inside their den, over on the table was some papers laid out with blue drawings all over them. Didn't know what in the world that was. And Carson said, "Preacher, my wife's been going to your church." I said, "Yeah, I know." He said, "She's different. I don't know what you did to her, but she's different." "So my daughter's different too." He said, "But I didn't know how different until last night." He said, "Last night," he said, "I was a little drunk." I said, "I heard about that." I said, "My wife said something to me after I come in. And I had asked her to say it again this morning because I thought I was too drunk last night to hear it." I said, "But when she told me again this morning, I realized something." He said, "My wife's daddy died a few years ago. He gave her some property that he owned. And he said, my wife loved her daddy more than she loves me. So when he died, she loved that property more than she loved me. And she loves that piece of property more than she loves me or her children or anything else in this world." He said, "But she asked me last night and again this morning if she could give it to the church." He said, "I want to know if you want it." I said, "All depends. Where is it?"
I mean, what did I pray? He said, well, south of town, not too far south, 2.2 miles south of town, on Highway 301, up on a hill, right beside the golf course. Holes 2 and 3 dog-legged around the property, friend. You talk about value, that thing had value. He said, you want it? I said, how many acres is it? He said, 13.5. I said, I'll take it. And God gave us that property at 3:30 in the afternoon. Went there that night to church. I couldn't help it. We had a packed house. People come to see the preacher made a fool of. I told Ann not to tell anybody. I went walking in like this. Wasn't that mean? I sat up there during the service like this. Everybody in there, their spirits just went. And then I got up and told them about that, and it took me 20 minutes to calm them down. They went to jumping, shouting, hugging, crying, screaming, hollering. They did everything but roll. One of them took a few laps around the church. I mean, we had a time. Well, now that still leaves Carson not knowing he's saved. Ann came to me that Wednesday night and said, after you left today, Carson said he thought you was a little different than any preacher he'd ever seen before. He couldn't figure out why you didn't just grab that property. But I told him what you'd prayed, and you wanted to make sure it matched it. He said Carson was impressed with that, and he wants to come Sunday to church. Said he'd be here Sunday morning. I said, you bring him. Ann always sat right here. We had one middle aisle, that's it, just two sections. She sat about right here, about 5 rows back on the end. She always sat there. I said, you bring him. Saturday night, I planned a good one. Boy, I laid out a sermon for Carson, wouldn't wait. I was geared, ready, loaded up for Carson's hands. Sunday morning got there. I was excited. I couldn't wait to see Carson. Got my time to preach, and I got up and looked, and Carson wasn't in there. And I looked at Ann, and she just went, he wasn't coming. And I was loaded for Carson. See, God won't let you box him in. God's going to work the way he wants to work. And when you think you've got him figured out, he'll take a detour just to show you that he's boss. And there I was loaded for Carson, and he wasn't nowhere in sight. I preached it anyway, and God honored it, and somebody got saved. But I want you to know, friends, it really broke my heart to realize how I'd gotten in the flesh and tried to take matters into my own hands. Sunday night, I didn't care if Carson's hands came or not. I just wanted to obey God. Sunday night, Ann was sitting there, had a vacant seat beside her for Carson, just in case he came. I looked at her in the song service. She shook her head no again. Had a good friend who helped me start that church named Dr. Drake, medical doctor in that area, been doctoring for 40-something years. A man that loved Jesus like nothing I'd ever seen before in my life. He always sat in the back. He was the head husher. Y'all taught me that. He was a head husher. He sat back there in the back, and he always kept a couple of vacant chairs back there for people who came in late, and he'd always greet folks. But the main reason he sat in the back is so he could help me count hands or help me point the hands that went up that was lost, because he didn't want his preacher to miss nobody. And I'd be looking out over on this side, and somebody raised a hand over there, and he'd be jumping up and down like that back there in the back. Over there, over there. Wanted to make sure. He loved to see people get saved. Every time somebody gets saved, he'd cry like a baby. 60-something years old, he'd cry like a baby because folks were getting saved. Ann thought Carson wasn't there. But right before I got up to preach, I saw them double doors crack back there. And I saw this nose come in the door. And Carson stuck his head in, and Dr. Drake saw him, and they'd been friends for some time. And he brought him on in, and he sat him down. Now, Dr. Drake is smart. I told you there was one aisle. He put a folding chair right in the middle of that aisle against the back wall. So there wasn't nobody between me and Carson that whole service. I mean, he set him down where all he'd have to do is just get up and walk straight. He didn't have to walk around nobody or nothing. He gave him a straight aisle right down there.
I got up and preached.
And still don't know Carson's there. I didn't give her the sign or nothing. She's still as disappointed as she can be. Sitting right there on the end seat. I got up and preached. Got through preaching and gave the invitation. I said, now who wants to come forward? I asked for them to raise their hands. And a couple of folks raised their hand. And then Carson didn't raise his. I said, now who wants to come forward? Get up and come. And then two folks that raised their hand didn't come. And I thought, well, now, if they ain't going to come, nobody's going to get saved because Carson didn't raise his hand. And by the time I saw Carson look around, and he looked at Dr. Drake, and Dr. Drake went. And Carson just eased on up and started down that aisle. Now, we had a tile floor, see? No carpet. And Ann, bless her heart, she always rejoiced in people getting saved. And every time somebody gets saved, they'd have to walk down that aisle. And they'd have to walk by her every time. And she'd always look to see who was getting saved so she could enjoy it, see, so she could pray for them. I asked her about that one time. She said, well, I got a verse of Scripture for it. I said, what is it? She said, the Bible says, watch and pray. And that's what I'm doing. And Carson starts walking down that aisle. Got on khaki brown pants that you wear, farmers would wear. Got on a khaki shirt. And he come walking down that aisle. And Ann could hear them footsteps. And just as the person got even with her, she started looking like that. And she hit them khaki browns. And she went on up. And she saw that it was Carson. And he went on by her. And when he did, she jumped straight up in the air and said, that's him! That's him! He's going to get saved! She went over and grabbed a friend of hers and said, look at yonder, he's gone down. And boy, she headed out. She said, hallelujah, glory to God, that's great. And I'm down there trying to win Carson to the Lord. There wasn't no way. I gave him to an associate pastor. I said, get him out of here. He got him out, won the Lord in the back of his down there just having a hallelujah time. A couple of her friends down there with her. That fuss Methodist church lady with them glasses now dangling by the necklace. And that fur coat about halfway off said, hallelujah! Glory to God! God working a miracle in your life will knock the dignity slap out of you. There ain't no place for dignity in serving God. Because you just can't stay dignified and watch the power of God work in your life. Even as pretty and dignified as you look. I've seen you lose your dignity some this week. Amen. That man, bless his heart, I love him. But I want you to know, Ann Sands will never be the same. And you know what Carson told me afterwards? Carson said, preacher, I got saved for one reason. I said, what was that? I knew it was 1 Peter 3, but he didn't. He said, when Ann gave up that piece of land, I knew that there was a God that meant more to her than her daddy. He said, if there was a God like that, I wanted to know Him. And he said, it wasn't until I saw my wife give up the dearest thing to her life. It wasn't until then that I knew what she had was real. Some of us go through life hanging on to the things that are dearest in our lives. And the lost people around us that are dearest to us know it. They see it. And they say to themselves, if their God is that good and that special and that powerful, how come they are so tight and so stingy? And how come they're hanging on to that thing in their lives, whatever it is? Why isn't their God greater than that thing in their lives? And you're holding somebody back from heaven. You're sending somebody slapping to hell because God's not first in every area of your life. And when I told Ann that, she just wept like a little baby. She said, I never thought that my love for my daddy and that piece of property was sending Carson to hell. She said, but I'd give up a whole world to see anybody saved. And that lady got set free. So did Carson. I told you he had about 600, well, he had thousands of acres set aside for hunting, but he had a 600 acre game preserve right on the edge of Fort Stewart. And Fort Stewart's an army base down there to where you don't go on there and hunt except by special permission. So all the deer know that, and the wild hogs, and they hang around there. And Carson had it set up, fenced in, folks, 600 acres, where nobody could hunt on it except people in his party. And they hunted every year, drinking and hunting and just having a wild time. Deer season rolled around a couple of months after Carson got saved. He called me up one day and said, "Preacher, you want to go hunting?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Meet me out here at 6 in the morning." I said, "I don't know if I want to go that bad or not." I said, "You meet me out here, we'll go." I met Carson out there at 6, and he had seven of the scroungiest guys I've ever seen in my life. They were all his drinking buddies. He said, "Fellas, we're going hunting today." He said, "I want to introduce you to a new fella in our club. His name's Barry Westbrook, and he's my pastor. And for you fellas that don't already know, I got saved a couple of months ago. And I want you to know there's a few rule changes around this year. There won't be no drinking on my property. There won't be no cussing while we're hunting." And he said, "And we're going to stick to the limit. We're not going to break the law anymore either. Because I got saved and I want to do what's right." He said, "Before we go, I want my preacher to pray that God will watch over us, because I know how some of you guys shoot." Now, I knew what he was up to. I prayed the most detailed plan of salvation you've ever heard in all your life. Carson over there going, "Amen, amen, amen, amen." We hunted that day, got 3 deer and 2 men. In case some of you didn't catch on to that, no, we did not shoot them. They just got saved. And Carson from then on was responsible for seeing 72 adults get saved because of his life. And Ann just praising Jesus every service, lifting her hands, waving at the Lord, just praising God. And Carson sitting right there beside her. Ordained him a year later as a deacon. And that man became a powerhouse for God. Why? Because some little lady from the First Methodist Church who found Jesus to be real in her life was crazy enough to believe God meant what He said. And she was fully persuaded that He was able to perform that which He had said He would do. And because of that, she and Carson are praising Jesus today and living for Him. Who do you know that would come to Jesus if they saw Him become really first in your life? I want every head bowed and every eye closed. I wonder if there's anybody in here that'd say to me tonight, "Preacher, I'm not saved. I'm not a Christian. I'm like Lynn Sands or Ann Sands or even Carson Sands. I'm not saved. And I wish you'd pray for me. Would you lift your hand? Let me see it. And I'll pray for you." Anybody in here? God bless you. Thank God for your honesty. God bless you, ma'am. Thank God for your honesty. And God bless you, sir. Thank God for your honesty. Anybody else? "Preacher, I'm not saved. Pray for me." Thank you. You can put your hand down now. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? God bless you, sir. Thank God for your honesty. "Preacher, I'm not saved. I want you to pray for me. I'm not a Christian." Lift your hand. Let me see it. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? Any others now? You can put your hand down now. Anybody besides those who've already raised their hand? God bless you, young lady. Who else? Anybody else? Preacher, I'm not saved. I want you to pray for me. Lift your hand. Let me see it. Anybody else? God bless you. Thank God for your honesty. Anybody else? God bless you, sir. Thank God for you. Thank God for your honesty. Just like Carson's. Honest with God. Anybody else? Preacher, I'm not saved. Pray for me. Anybody else? God bless you. Thank God for you, young lady. Anybody else? Anybody else? Lift your hand. Let me see it. Anybody else? Father, in Jesus' name, you saw these people. You know their hearts. I want you to give them the courage now to say, I'm tired of going on like I've been going. I'm tired of doing without Jesus. It's time that I got honest. I've lifted my hand. I've admitted to this pastor and to God Himself that I'm lost. Now, Lord, give them the courage to say, I'm going to do something about it tonight. Lord, I'm so thankful. And when Carson Sands walked in and heard the truth, he decided to act on it. Lord, what a foolish thing it would be for these folks who've lifted their hands and said, I need Jesus, I'm lost. What a foolish thing for them to walk out without Jesus. So give them the courage to come. In Jesus' name.
Love will roll the clouds away, turn the dark into day. I'm so glad I now can say, love will roll the clouds away. Love will roll the clouds away, turn the dark into day. I'm so glad I now can say, love will roll the clouds away.
As along that should you go, clouds may hide the light of day, but have no fear, for friend you know, for God's love will roll the clouds away.
God is watching over all, and He hears each time you pray. So lift your voice in happy song. God's love will roll the clouds away.
Love will roll the clouds away. Turn the dark into day, turn the dark into day. I'm so glad I can stay. Love will roll the clouds away. Love will roll the clouds away. Turn the dark into day, turn the dark into day. I'm so glad I can say, love will roll the clouds away.
Brother Barry, I believe they're here tonight. They're with us. Bless your hearts. Sharon was telling me that someone spoke to her last night and said that a certain song that we sang must have been Sunday night because we had to wait for Doug to get here, encouraged her in witnessing. The song said, tell it to a few close friends. And she was wondering where to start, and she told a close friend, are you here, dear person, whoever you are? I don't know who it was. I don't know if Sharon knows who it was. But she did, and her friend said that she'd be here Thursday night. I know we get a lot of promises like that, but that's what it's all about. She started. She did her part. Now we have to wait on God to do His part, and He will. Tell it to a few close friends. I don't mind repeating songs because you need to hear it twice. Tell it to a few close friends.
Thank you.
You say you could do more if you just had talent, and we're given a place to begin. A place you could tell all the world about Jesus. We'll tell it to a few close friends. I'd be terrific if I could just travel and had a lot of money to spend. I wish I were a natural leader. Tell it to a few close friends.
You can tell it.
Tell it.
Tell it right where you live, and you got Jesus to recommend. You can tell it.
Tell it
to the world at your doorstep. Just tell it to a few close friends. You can tell it.
Tell it.
Tell it right where you live, and you got Jesus to recommend. You can tell it to the world at your doorstep. Just tell it to a few close friends.
All the talent in the family right there.
Well, and I'm ready to set this whole world on fire. And I'm going to, just as soon as my ship comes in.
Why don't you get your act together and tell it to a few close friends?
Don't worry about the questions and problems that the Spirit show you where and when. Relax and let love get to talking and start with just a few close friends. You can tell it,
tell it.
Tell it right where you live, and you got Jesus to recommend. You can tell it,
tell it
to the world at your doorstep. Just tell it to a few close friends. You can tell it,
tell it,
tell it right where you live, and you got Jesus to recommend. You can
tell it
to the world at your doorstep. Just tell it to a few close friends. Just tell it to a few close friends. Just tell it to a few close friends. I love to tell the story for those who know it best. Same hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when it scenes of glory, I sing the new song. 'Twill be the old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of my Jesus and his love. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we're gonna meet on that beautiful shore. Now I've a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure,
there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from His precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins He washed away, and my night He turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
For those of you that are worried, don't worry, I'm not going to pop. I just turned red and looked like it. That's my nature. Darren, you come and share this next song with us, if you would. Yeah, you. Dallas Holm is a well-known songwriter, and he wrote this particular song. It comes right from the scripture. God's promise to us. How many of you ever feel discouraged? Huh? It comes our way. How many of you are staying there? Hey, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. And I've never seen their seed begging for bread. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things, necessities of life, will be added unto you. Make Jesus Christ first in your life. And you can have the assurance that no matter how bad the problem seems, or no matter how long it may last, Jesus will see you through it. So look up. Keep your eyes on Jesus.
Oh, I know you may get weary, and the times they may get rough, and you may not have all you want, but you'll always have enough. And when you feel you're at the end, well, just remember what I said. I've never seen a righteous forsaken, or their seed begging for bread. And I know it seems so hopeless, and you don't know what to pray. You've done all you know to do, and it seems there's just no way. And when your darkest hour comes, well, just remember what I said. I've never seen a righteous forsaken, or their seed begging for bread. I've never seen God's people with a need that He could not meet. I know that He cares for His own, and His promises He'll keep. So just hold on a little longer, for the answer's soon to come. And and the endless waiting's almost over, and the victory is almost won. And when again you feel this joy, well, you'll remember what I said. I've never seen a righteous forsaken, or a thief begging for bread. I've never seen a righteous forsaken, or their seed begging for.